Can we bring it back? I wondered if you would join me in a little thought experiment this afternoon. Might be a little tricky. Thought experiments, you know, we have to imagine the impossible. But something tells me this audience might be up for it. Yes? Great. Okay, here's the setup. When you go home this evening, this afternoon, I want you to imagine that you turn on a newscast and they break a story. And they say that there's been a breakthrough invention of the digital information age, never been seen before. It's not a new gadget or a gizmo, but it will revolutionize everything, change everything. And for this, they take you out in the field to a reporter so they can show it to you. And the reporter says, "Here we are in the location of this invention, never been seen before. It's called education, school for short, and it looks like this. What do you see? Big brick building, a storefront, someone's living room." The reporter goes on and says, "You know, it involves children and teens. Look at them. What do you see? Young people behind desks in rows? Or something else?" And to conclude, the reporter says, "This education thing is supposed to result in something called learning, which is the development of the individual and, you know, preparation for the future. And it looks like this." In your mind's eye, what do you see? A student holding a piece of paper? An original invention? What? Okay, end of thought experiment. I told you a little tricky. I mean, education being invented today. Never seen before. Right. Part of the challenge, I think, is trying to escape that gravitational pull of the 150-year-old industrial age model that so informs and provides the basis of schools that we know and is employed largely today. For many, many people, it's the only model, mental model, that they have in their heads about how school can be. You know, students who are batch processed by age in classrooms along a conveyor belt toward graduation with processes that are largely derived from mass production. Yet, education is being invented every day across the globe, new, resulting in 21st century models that look very different from the schools that we have. This brings me great hope. It brings me great hope because when I started in my career in education, it was in a very, very dark, dark time in our country. The year was 1983, and disco was flourishing. And I really didn't think there was any hope. I didn't think any of us would make it. And I'm pleased to see by the music today that we have. But 1983 was also the publication of a federal summary, you may recall, ominously titled, "A Nation at Risk." It really is an artifact and hyperbole, but among other things, it said the following: "Our educational foundations are being eroded presently by a rising tide of mediocrity that threatens our future as a nation and a people." And I'm graduating from college and I'm thinking, well, that's great. You know, a way to choose a loser industry. The industry that I want to go into is performing so poorly it threatens the future of our country. Maybe I could still get involved in something less controversial, like healthcare or law enforcement. I wrote a paper that last year, and I remember the first sentence of it. I wrote, "There is a crisis of legitimacy in public education." I had no idea what I was talking about. In fact, that's a trait of a lot of my undergraduate writing. I didn't know what I had no experience, but I jumped into education. I became an English teacher at a brand new high school with wonderful mentor teachers, great administration, and it only took me a couple of years to know that there truly was something amiss in K-12 education. I noticed a couple of things. First, I did notice that the industrial model so informed all of schooling, right down to the classroom level, that it shaped the experience of children, students, K through 12. And I discovered over the years that many, many thoughtful educators would agree that this is an unfortunate situation for a number of reasons. First, the industrial model on which schools are largely based and still employ has no future going forward. Michael Fullan, the respected education author and researcher, I think said it best. He said, "We have squeezed the last good out of an outdated system. It's too costly, it's ineffective, and if you ask any kid, it's deadly boring." The fact is, knowledge is doubling almost every year now. And for a model that is preoccupied with content absorption and content consumption, that model can't keep up. Probably even more insidiously, though, the industrial model and its mass production processes and bureaucracy generates in millions of people what is now known as a fixed mindset, as opposed to a growth mindset. This comes from the work of Carol Dweck at Stanford University. Fixed mindset is the learned belief that one is inherently not good or incapable at learning or knowing something, and that risking mistake is to be avoided at all cost. Ask any current or former student. Ask yourself, where did you learn that you weren't good at a particular subject? Oh, math, writing, science, or some skill. And this stigma can follow people throughout their entire lives. It's tragic, and it's completely unnecessary. Finally, when we learn that the majority of students who do graduate and go on to enroll in post-secondary programs in college do not complete in 5 years, the majority, we have to ask the question, what good is a model? What was it designed to do well those many generations ago? The second thing I noticed early on and ever since was that there was going to be a parade of reforms, externally imposed visiting schools and school systems designed to fix the industrial model or to realize some results that were not forthcoming. There have been so many reforms in my career, I can't list them for you here today, and I can't even remember them. I've repressed them kind of like bad memories. But you may know some of them. For instance, No Child Left Behind, you heard of, in the mid-90s, which ushered in an accountability era and a fixation on standardized test scores. The central observation here is that the experience of the child largely does not change. The reforms last about a decade and a half, and then they're forgotten. Educators tell a joke when they get together. I've heard this more often than not in graduate classes. So much reform, so little change. Well, why is that? Well, educators have another saying, and it goes like this. Culture eats strategy for lunch. You may have heard that. Reforms come in with their strategies and for things for change, but culture will eat strategy for lunch. And it's been my observation that that's exactly what happens. There's a modern variant of that, however, and it goes like this. Culture will outlive any reform. And it does. Yet, you will note that the ed reform impulse is at a fever pitch today, right? You've heard of them, Common Core State Standards, teacher evaluation schemes, new standardized tests to be taken online, and everybody is fighting about all aspects of them. I believe it's the wrong conversations, and the work to be done is still out there yet. And to understand this, I turn to Ron Heifetz, who is the founder and director of the Center for Public Leadership at Harvard. He reminds us that there are no dysfunctional organizations. They don't exist. Organizations produce the results for which they were designed. The dysfunction comes when we expect different results from an organization that was never designed to produce them. It is my contention that ed reform, as we know it, can never fix the industrial model. Because it can't be fixed. It is functioning as it was designed many generations ago. If we are to realize our highest aspirations for the education of our children, I believe that we must stop the churn, the expensive and time-consuming churn of education reform, and embark boldly on a process of redesign. The conversation should be about design or redesign and the generation of 21st century learning models. Redesign, leveraging what we now know about how humans learn and how knowledge-based organizations can be so configured that they raise the capacity of everybody to adapt to changing environments. Redesign results in the opposite of reform. Reform attempts to evolve a model that can't and won't. Redesign creates new organizations with new organizational DNA and transforms the learning experience of the student, from which we can expect different results. How do I know this? I know it because I've seen it, and I've lived it, and I'm living it today. I have the privilege of working with a group of very, very bright people to create a new model for middle school and high school locally called Pride Prep. But we are not alone. Last spring, I was invited to a conference in San Diego, put on by the Hewlett Foundation, called the Deeper Learning Conference. And there gathered 400 educators from across the globe, all working on the redesign and the generation of new educational models. It was thrilling. The first day, I sat across from an administrator from a school district north of San Diego, who, with a design team of teachers and pushed by an informed school board and a visionary superintendent, were creating a new model for elementary and middle school. They were asking and deciding the transformational questions. Questions like, how might we use time profoundly different to get students where we want them to be? How might we focus on improvement and growth, especially the growth mindset? How might we arrange the adults in the organization to not only have students master core content and 21st century skills, but how might we bring forth those things that we all believe students, young people are going to need in their future, but are never tested for or marked on grade forms? Things like persistence, resilience, courage, confidence, empathy, self-control, just to name a few. The industrial model had been excused from the building, and parents were enrolling their students like crazy. By the way, this conference, the Deeper Learning Conference, was being held on the campus of a K-12 system in San Diego who've been working on their model since 2001. They have a 10,000 student waiting list. Their graduation rate is 100%. Their post-secondary program enrollment is near that, near 100%. And 5 years after graduation, their follow-on completion rate is 93%. And all of this work is being done in refurbished Navy warehouses. You see, the future of education is not a building, not even a new one. It definitely is what goes on inside any building, anywhere now. The future of education is not a massive infusion of cash, even if it is court-ordered. For who would invest billions of dollars in a model that has no future? In the words of Grant Lichtman, an educational writer, schools are going to have to redesign or face utter irrelevance. John Legend sings, "The future started yesterday and we're already late." The good news is there's lots of educators willing to do the redesign work. What they need is permission. Permission from policymakers, especially at the state level, state boards of education, legislators, and they need visionary leadership to help guide the process. Our role is to insist on redesign, not reform. And when we do that, Sir Ken Robinson's dream of a learning revolution will surely be at hand. Thank you.